Hello to our Local 6 viewers. My name is John Leisenring, Dr. John Leisenring. I'm the other Dr. John, as many people refer to me. And this is the second in a series of classes celebrating the greatness of American music. Our first class, which was last week, featured the early strains through New Orleans. And we mentioned ragtime, we mentioned boogie woogie and stride piano as far as the piano was concerned. And we also dwelt on the early horn playing, especially the early Louis Armstrong and so on. This class, which will really focus on Louis Armstrong almost in its entirety, as the music becomes much more of an art music and much less of simply an entertainment. We'll also spend a little time with Bix Beiderbecke, who was the other cornet player that actually when Louis met Bix, he said that he realized that they were both working on the same thing, which was kind of the freeing up melodically and harmonically, really, of the idiom for improvisation. So we hope you enjoy what's going to follow, and here we go. To review, I will just play snippets of the music that I played last week so you can refresh on that, and indeed people who didn't get to hear it. And this is a very quick review of what we talked about, and I know some of you can't read it, but basically last week's lecture was about the fact that American music is an amalgam of European musical structures and African music. Eurocentric music and Afrocentric music come together in the American South, but not in the part of the South which was not a French populated thing. The New Orleans community had a hierarchy of slavery. There were Creole blacks, which were primarily mixed race slaves, but those were the people that were educated, that knew music. There's African American, they were black string quartet, black symphony orchestras in New Orleans in the middle part of the 19th century. So they were not only educated, they were accomplished musicians, and they were playing contemporary music. That is to say, Debussy and Ravel, contemporary French music. The field blacks, the uneducated blacks, and the Creole blacks lived together and socialized together. So the people that worked in the house and were part of the house structure didn't stay there. They had to go out back where the people lived. And over generations of time, European musical tendencies and African musical tendencies combined. Europe was about melody and harmony, and we talked about that a little bit. And Africa was about rhythm and timbre, tone, colors. T-I-M-B-R-E is timbre. And the example I used was a drum set, a drum kit. You've probably all had some association with that. And you could tell if somebody hit a drum or a cymbal. You probably could tell if they hit two or three different cymbals with different sounds, certainly different drums. That's timbre. That's the different kinds of colors. And it was primarily drumming, but not entirely. And those things, over time, over generations, combined into a kind of music that had all four of those elements, rhythm and timbre and melody and harmony. And then we spent the rest of that examining various aspects of that. We talked about ragtime as an entity versus the blues. We talked about ragtime going to stride piano style and the blues going to boogie-woogie piano style. And I'll play just a little bit of these kinds of things. And then I listed some artists that we talked about. Scott Joplin was the major ragtime composer. There was no real improvisation involved in what he did. He wrote that stuff down. The forms were just like military marches, the same kind of musical form that Sousa used for his marches and all of those people. The blues was an entirely different thing. It was about the feelings, the soul of the African-American community and all of their anguish because they were in slavery for generations, but also all of the joys and elevation and so on that went into that kind of life in those times. It surfaces again in the latter part of the 19th century and on into the early 20th century. And then Boogie Woogie was a piano style that came out of that blues format. Scott Joplin, Robert Johnson was a rural blues performer. simply sitting on a back porch playing guitar and singing. There was no need for a kind of rhythmic structure, that is to say a time structure, because there weren't any other musicians involved. As soon as two or more musicians come together, then there has to be some kind of tie together, or they can't play together. And I played Bessie Smith with Louis Armstrong playing cornet and that funny little pump organ that was accompanying them. I'll show you that. James P. Johnson was a stride piano player, and stride was a term that meant the left hand with the root of the chord down here and the chord here. Chick, ding, chick, ding, chunk, ding, chunk. And that really came out of the rhythm section, we can use that term, of a marching band, where the tubas were down here and the various instruments that played the afterbeats, bop, 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 was what's going on up here. And that left hand was independent, totally. And there was things going on up here that had the raggedy rhythms, had the syncopated rhythms, melody, harmony, rhythm, all of that tied together in the right hand of stride piano players, as opposed to a boogie-woogie style, which was not entirely different because there was a constant rhythmic and sort of melodic thing down here in the left hand. You've heard it, ba ba do ba do be do be do ba do da dee, over and over again, following the chord progressions of the blues, with again very complex animated kinds of music on top of it, independent hands and so on. And then I put down here Big Mama Thornton because it dawned on me. I heard Big Mama Thornton doing You Ain't Nothing But a Hound Dog the other day, and we talked about the fact that when Elvis did You Ain't Nothing But a Hound Dog, those lyrics were sanitized for 50s high school white kids. They didn't dare put the original lyrics on those records that sold to us when we were in junior high school. So I brought Big Mama in, and I'll play that for you too, so you can hear a little bit of the original lyrics, which, as I told you, is telling her abusive man, get out of my life. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. Come creeping around my door. She says at one point in time, I ain't gonna feed you no more. You know, get out of my life, go away. That's not what we heard on Ed Sullivan when Elvis played You Ain't Nothing But a Hound Dog. They had a basset hound in there, for God's sake. You ain't never killed a rabbit, you ain't no friend of mine. It was how they completely changed those lyrics. If I knew you better, there's lots of blues lyrics. And I could tell you the originals, but they get pretty saucy pretty fast. As opposed to what came out on the records for the white kids, and it is about that. I remember distinctly being lured into Plimpton's music store in Whitefish Bay, Wisconsin in the mid-50s when I was walking home from school. And he would literally say, "Psst, come in here and listen to this." And he was presenting me with what was the very contemporary jazz at that time. But what he didn't know, until I told him, was that at night, late at night, I was listening to the Moondog Show coming out of Cleveland in the early 50s, because in Milwaukee, the combination of the ozone skip, and we won't get into that, and Lake Michigan, I could pick it up at night. And I loved that music. And I didn't know it was what in the business was called race records. And so I went into Plimpton's music store, and innocently enough, asked for some of these things I was hearing. And I remember he said, "You're going to have to go downtown to the record stores down there." But it didn't take them a minute and a half to figure out that there was gold in white teenagers' pockets, and that so-called race records started finding their way into the record stores that we populated. And as they say, the rest is history. Anyway, let me play just a little bit of all of this, primarily for people that weren't here, but also as a review of the kind of sounds that we heard. We talked, first of all, about ragtime, and we played Scott Joplin's Maple Leaf Rag. And this was written out, composed music. It contained what at the time was called raggedy rhythms, syncopation. And that's why the term ragtime developed. Interesting that it's a piano, a player piano role, and this is actually Scott Joplin playing his Maple Leaf Rag, because he was playing the piano that cut the holes and the rolls that could then be sold in the stores for people to play on their player pianos. And I said that there are lots of people from that era who became piano players, including, for instance, Duke Ellington, learned to play the piano by putting their fingers on the keys that went down, because the player piano's keys did go down. They had to in order to strike the strings. It was the holes in the roll, though, that forced that, and they would learn how to play piano by simply putting their fingers on the keys that and learning the tunes that way and so on, which sounds kind of tedious. But in certain lifestyles, and you can figure out which ones, the very impoverished people, they didn't have teachers. They might have had a player piano, and that was where they used for their teaching. Now, somebody like Jelly Roll Morton would take that same tune in a couple of years and add major improvisational techniques to it. And it's no longer written out anymore. This is what he would do to that maple leaf rag as an improviser. Whole different deal, same song. And so on. Now, I talked about stride piano. Coming out of this, there's a little bit of what Jelly Roll Morton is doing with his left hand, but listen to James P. Johnson, who is the champion stride piano player of the era, playing a tune of his called Carolina Shout. That left hand is almost a machine-like. And it never misses. I've watched people do it, and they're astonishing, because it's a big reach. This is independent. Now this is Mead Lux Lewis playing boogie style. And the left hand is still doing, the term in music is ostinato. But listen to the independent hands. And so on. You get the idea. Now let's go back and talk about the blues a little bit, which comes from a completely different place. The blues comes out of the fields, the shouts and hollers of the workers in the fields. It also comes out of the church gospel music that over the generations the black people learned one way or another. But it still maintains the feeling that comes out of Africa. It maintains the attitude of the people in their lifestyle, which was, of course, brutal. And yet, in their celebratory times, which they had, it also represented the joys of their community and so on. The first example I played was what's called rural blues. And rural blues simply means somebody who's singing or playing the blues by themselves. They don't have a band. You heard that there was a drummer, perhaps, in one of the piano things. Immediately there has to be a form that's sacred. You can't deviate from it, or people will get lost from each other. Well, Robert Johnson is going to sing all by himself. We can sort of imagine on the back porch of a shack down south someplace, singing his story, and the lyrics are "Hellhound on My Trail." It's very much, I think, voodoo oriented, which was the imported religion from Africa. It's not about sticking pins in dolls like the late 40s movies would have us believe. It's about a multi-god religious structure. And the drumming in the various circle dances of the voodoo ceremonies was pointed at a specific god. If they if there was a need for the god of agriculture, for instance, or the god of fill in the blank, there were drummers that specialized in one god or another. And that would be the drummer that would drum. And those rhythms would hopefully call the god down. And indeed, the words often involve something like rider, my little old rider, my little old sweet rider. The god would come and ride on the back of the dancer or dancers in their thinking. And if that could happen, and sometimes the dances lasted for hours, and there was still some of that going on as late as now in New Orleans, but certainly in the 20th century out on Lake Pontchartrain and around, and there, I understand there's a Haitian community in New York that still maintains some connection to the circle dance, to the voodoo traditions. And I always told my classes, if we the world has gotten to the point where there's almost no place you could go that doesn't have some kind of Western influence. And so when we hear African music now, I mean music in Africa, it isn't the way it was three, four, five centuries ago. Can't be. Imagine us being wrenched out of our culture and taken to another planet with a completely different set of everything. And the things that we would hold on, and that was the way it was for them. Because coming to this continent on those ships in that situation was like being in a completely different universe for them. What would you hold on to? What would be most dear to you? And of course, it would be your cultural things, your religious things, the various aspects of your past life that you were just unwilling to let go of. And that's exactly what happened, very understandably. Over the generations, that also was changing, of course, as the culture moved on. And by the time we get to 1900 in New Orleans and around, it has become what it's become. But the religion, the drum was banned in plantation life in numerous times. The plantation owners felt that the drum was sending signals from plantation to plantation, which it was, and they felt that it had some sort of bizarre connection to some sort of bizarre religion, i.e. not Christianity, which it did. And so they tried to squelch that. They tried to ban the drums, and people died because they would do things that were against those particular rules. But what's developed, and it remains to this day, is you can't hold the drum down. The drum will bubble to the surface somehow. And it bubbled to the surface in around 1900 in the kind of music that we're talking about. We don't know what it sounded like because recordings didn't start happening until the very late teens and on into the early 20s. And at that time, the recordings were not made by black people. They were made by white people because they had the entree into the business. As a matter of fact, they also got credit for the compositions and got paid for them. And of course, the black people didn't. It very quickly, though, developed that black people began to record, and that's where we're going to pick it up today. But let me play a couple of examples of the blues for you before we do that. This is Robert Johnson.
I've got to keep moving, I've got to keep moving. Blues falling down like hail.
Blues falling down like hail. He says, I got to keep moving. And he'll repeat that. Sort of.
Blues falling down like hail, blues falling down like hail. And the day keeps on running, it's a hellhound on my trail, hellhound on my trail.
Now, Robert Johnson is considered the greatest example we have of early rural blues. There were plenty of blues singers, but they all didn't get on recording. And when they did, often it wasn't quite as explicit as what this is in terms of the form. It's AAB structure. There's four bars of text which will repeat. You ain't nothing but a hound dog crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog crying all the time. And then a B section. You ain't never killed a rabbit and you ain't no friend of mine. That's a form that is standard. He's using that form, but he's not using a straight meter because he doesn't have to. And so some things are stretched, some things are not. Bessie Smith, with Louis Armstrong singing St. Louis Blues, is a little bit more structured. Matter of fact, it's a lot more structured because she's singing, he's playing, actually he's playing cornet in this case, and there's an organ player playing along with it. And you'll see that there's a form structure so that they all can be at the same place at the same time. There's the second A section, same lyrics. Here comes the B section of the text. Now, I won't trouble you with the chords and the harmonies, but they're there. The blues has a very distinct form. It's 12 bars long, 12 measures long. And, well, I will trouble you with it, I guess, but you don't necessarily know the language. It's a one chord for four measures, a four chord for two measures, a one chord for two measures, a five chord for two measures, and a one chord for two measures. 12 bars, trust me. And one, four, five simply means what chords come along at what time. Johnson was doing that. It was just so foggy in the rural style that it would be kind of hard to pick out. But this is real obvious. If they're in the key of B flat, they go to E flat. They go back to B flat. They go to F. They go back to B flat. That's enough theory, but at least you know it's there. There is a musical structure that can't be changed. It has to stay the same. Otherwise, people couldn't play together. Now, I did bring in Big Mama Thornton singing You Ain't Nothing But a Hound Dog because I thought you'd get a kick out of it. Think back to Elvis Presley. We're all old enough probably that we remember the mid-50s when Elvis Presley sang You Ain't Nothing But a Hound Dog, crying all the time, you ain't never killed a rabbit and you ain't no friend of mine, and it got all the way to Ed Sullivan. And I remember him on television singing to this dog. But this is where it came from. Only a few years earlier, I think the recording was made in the late 40s, and Big Mama Thornton, I can't even think what her real name was. Thornton was her real last name, but I can't remember what her first name was. She was just Big Mama, and this is what she sounded like.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog.
Here's the fourth bar. Chord changed. Chords changed. You can wag your tail, but I ain't gonna feed you no more. You ain't no real cool cat. So that's the blues. And in this case, of course, she's really letting her anguished heart out for this life that's not working. Get your ass out of here, go bother somebody else, is what she's saying. And it didn't make the cut as far as the mid-50s was concerned for Elvis and them. Now, Elvis Presley started, this is a kind of a parenthesis, but when he started, he was reclaiming a lot of the old, we call it rhythm and blues tunes, black rhythm and blues tunes. It was when he signed with RCA Victor and they made him change that format in order to make him what he became. That started happening. But he didn't change the lyrics, or the people that he was working with didn't, early on. And those Elvis Presley recordings are of major historical importance. And I consider Elvis Presley to be one of the real, strong historical figures in American music until he got to the point where Colonel Tom, whatever his name was, bought the contract, and they got the Jordanaires to be backup singers and, you know, all the rest of it. Elvis never did want to be what we talk about early on. He wanted to be a movie star, and of course that all happened, and you know that. I told the class last week, Mahalia Jackson, who was one of the very, very best gospel singers of all time, said that her main influence in terms of presenting the music emotionally was Bessie Smith that I played for you. It's just that Mahalia Jackson was so involved with her church that she refused to perform except on Sunday. And the one time that she played, that she sang with Duke Ellington's band, Come Sunday is the tune, on the Newport Jazz Festival in 1958, she refused to go on stage after midnight on Saturday night. So she didn't sing until Sunday. It would happen to have been just a few minutes past midnight, but that was as close as she came to being willing to perform in a format other than in church. But the feeling that she sang with and the feeling that you hear coming out of Bessie Smith and Moms May, all of those people, is soul. And then we talk about that all the time. When I played Big Mama Thornton, you might have been reminded of Janis Joplin, if you know her music at all, from the San Francisco rock and roll era. Janis knew every note of every Big Mama record that there was, and she covered a lot of Big Mama's stuff, Ball and Chain and some of those things. Those are covers. That's a term we use for redoing a song in another style, or maybe not. But Janis, of course, was one of the rock and roll shouters. And if you heard the beginning of Big Mama in the 40s, then, you know, that's not opera singing, folks. And some people would say it's not singing at all. But it certainly is telling stories. Oh, and I wanted to say, think back for a minute to that recording. She sings a line, and you'll hear the guitar player answer her. And the call and response comes all the way from Africa, through the fields, the shouts and hollers. That's a very standardized thing that happens, and it's going to come up in band writing before we get through this lecture today, with that call and response feel. Somebody does something, somebody answers it. I had occasion last night to play at the Ohio Club, and back, not really back, but as we say, obbligato, with a singer. And the trick of it, if there's a trick, is to let him sing and then add a comment about the time he takes a breath. But the back and forthness is such an Afrocentric tradition. The other Afrocentric tradition that I've mentioned today, but I did last week, was storytelling. And one of the aspects of the blues, as you now know, is telling stories. And that will come up in today's lecture as well, if I just remember at the time to mention it again. But the storytelling had to do with the fact that in much of the tradition that came out of Africa, there was no written language. And so in order to know the history, in order to know about ancestral developments and this and that and the other, there were within the culture storytellers, and they knew the history, and people would gather around campfires or whatever. And I don't mean to indicate that these people are not civilized people. They came, a lot of the people that came over to be slaves came from communities of 200,000-300,000 people. There was an organized civilization, not unlike Native Americans, who also had that tradition of storytelling, and they still do. And in order to find out some of the things about the history, you have to find the old grandmother over someplace that knew the history and would tell the stories, and people would listen with rapt attention, because that was, you couldn't go to the library, and may lightning strike me, and do research and find out things, because there wasn't a written language. Okay, we teetered on the brink last week of Louis Armstrong. Indeed, we played a couple of examples. Louis Armstrong, very early in his life, is hired by King Oliver to come to Chicago and be a part of King Oliver's band there. And so and that starts an exodus of musicians. Actually, it doesn't start it, but it continues an exodus of musicians from the South to the North, and primarily from New Orleans to Chicago. Chicago because, of course, in those days, and I'm talking about the 20s, there was work up there where there wasn't in the South for those people. So they went up there simply to make a living. And it wasn't necessarily musicians, of course. It was people to go work in the factories, the steel mills of Gary, this, that, and the other. And there were other places to go, Pittsburgh, Philadelphia. But music went to Chicago because Chess Records was there. Phil and his brother, I forget, Chess, had a recording studio that would record black musicians. And they knew that. And the trail, the route, was no longer the riverboats, which had been bringing the music at least as far as Memphis and St. Louis, but Highway 61. Highway 61 from, I guess, New Orleans, all the way up to Memphis and beyond, catch the boat there, but somehow get from there on into Chicago. So Highway 61 is very famous in the history of the music. Bob Dylan turned out a record that was Highway 61 Revisited. I think it's still possible, but I know it was until recently possible to take a bus tour from Memphis down to New Orleans and stop at a lot of the very famous juke joint places, Greenville, and not Greenville, that's in South Carolina, Mississippi. Anyway, look at the map, and it just goes right along the Mississippi River all the way down to New Orleans, and all kinds of blues joints, all kinds of blues clubs existed along there, and the musicians would work their way north. They'd play for a week or a night or however long, make some money, go further. The goal was Chicago, and the goal was the studios of Phil and his brother Chess, Chess Records, and most of those labels early on are, if they're not on a race label like OK, O-K-E-H, and some others, it's on Chess, because that was a place where, and it was a big deal, white-owned, high-dollar recording studio where much of that was done. Okay, so we get up there, and Louis Armstrong has put together for him two small groups, five-piece band and a seven-piece band, and they were called Louis Armstrong's Hot Five and Louis Armstrong's Hot Seven. It wasn't musicians that he necessarily hired, but they were musicians primarily from New Orleans that he had played with down there that either had found their way up there or got dragged up there by Louis and also by King Oliver. We played the King Oliver example last time, and I won't do that again. I don't even remember which one we played. We also played the Jelly Roll Morton and his Red Hot Peppers, and I said that Jelly Roll Morton was the first guy, really, that solved the problem of getting this kind of music in an ensemble, in a band. What are going to be the various functions of the various instruments? The drums do this, the bass, which was tuba originally, does this, the banjo and guitar do this, the horn players do this, and it was organized in such a way that it made musical sense, and it was a good start toward what we're going to talk about now, which was what was beginning to develop in Chicago. The dates are really the late 20s. Some of the recordings were later than that, but the style is not. The style is definitely 20s. So let me play you a couple of examples of Louis Armstrong and his Hot Five, I think, first. Well, it doesn't even say here, but let's just do them one at a time. In no particular order. This is Dipper Mouth Blues. Is the title of the tune. I think Lil Hardin wrote it. Lil Hardin is playing piano in the band, and Lil Hardin either has already become or is about to become Mrs. Louis Armstrong. So some of the tune credits, which she's now getting credit for, will say Lil Hardin as a composer. It's too late, she's already passed, and we can't give her the residuals. Or it'll say Lil Hardin Armstrong. But either way, many of the standard so-called Dixieland tunes that we all know, she wrote for this group and others. Five of them. Thank you. Now, you can't really hear the bass, and that's because the recording technique is pretty basic. But the bass has got a role, and it's primarily involved with just simply thumping out the rhythm. But in this case, the bass is her left hand, because there isn't a bass player in the band. There's only five of them. So she's playing basically this on the piano while they do what they do. The trumpet, in this case it's a cornet, is playing the melody and is free to not necessarily play the exact melody, because I'm sure it was not written out. I just know that at least some of these players, and probably all of them, couldn't read music anyway. The clarinet is embellishing over the top of that melody. And you can, if you really listen, you can hear the clarinet in there. The trombone is embellishing the bass. It's a style that we call tailgate trombone, because much of the music was played on a wagon in parades and one thing and another. And the only place for the trombone slide was off the back end of the wagon. Thus, the trombone player sat on the tailgate of the wagon. And thus, we still think about playing tailgate style trombone. So I'll play some more of this for you. Hear the piano? Now, what you just heard didn't happen in New Orleans much, maybe not at all. That extended solo, improvised solo by the clarinet player, is new. And people talk about this as being Dixieland or New Orleans style, and it really isn't, because down there, they just didn't do that much soloing. There were little two-bar breaks. Remember, those of you who were here last week, little things that they would interject, a solo clarinet or a solo trumpet, solo trombone, but basically no soloing. Now, they are already beginning to think about being a soloist. We'll play the melody, we'll get through all that, but then let's have space for some individual creativity. And that's what the clarinet just played. Let's see what else happens here. Still clarinet. When they get back to an ensemble, it is the same New Orleans style that came north to Chicago. Louis Armstrong on cornet. Without getting too esoteric, what's happening is the development of a style that is almost impossible to write down. I mean, people, we all, as we tried to learn how to play this kind of music, would take recordings by various people, copy down what they played, and then learn it, just like you would learn it out of an etude book at piano lessons or whatever it was. The problem was that the music was so complex rhythmically that decisions had to be made. How can you write it down on a five-line staff so that you can come back around again and play it? I have a published book of trombone solos by a jazz trombone player, J.J. Johnson, and I had to make a lot of decisions about that because it just didn't fit. In a way, it was almost like a square peg in a round hole. It doesn't notate. Well, it didn't come off of notation. They played the way they felt. And the style that develops and becomes the standard is what Louis Armstrong is developing at this time. The people that come along afterwards obviously spent a great deal of time listening to these records, which was the only way to learn it back in the day. You couldn't go buy a book and learn how to play what they played, because one, it wasn't there, and two, it really couldn't be put down on paper anyway. Not really. The transcribed solo book that I have has a thing that says, for heaven's sakes, go get the records. Don't believe that you're going to get the whole of it by reading what I wrote down here. This is just to get you started. You need to know what J.J. Johnson really sounded like playing this stuff, and you need to get to where you sound like that. I mean, I did that. I recorded myself and put them side by side and tried to get as close to the way that style felt as I possibly could. And I wasn't the only one doing it by any stretch of the imagination. That's how we learned how to play this kind of music. And I'm talking about hour after hour after day after week after month of trying to get my playing to sound the way I wanted it to sound based on what I was hearing, which is what we all did. I mean, I don't know anybody in the jazz world that can't say, yeah, I got a year or two when I played 6 hours a day, 8 hours a day, and constantly listening. And the people that are trying to play swing style in band, in orchestra, God forbid, and all, haven't listened enough to really be able to do that. They're reading it off the page. Those of us who are teaching can say, it's this, that, the other, here's what you have to do. But if you haven't invested the listening time, it's not a written art. It's an oral art. And here's where it starts. It really does start with Louis Armstrong. Another example, a tune that Lil Hardin wrote called Hotter Than That. And he sings on this, and that also is the beginning of scat singing, you'll hear. Now think about accents and non-accents, which is what swing is all about in part. There's one of those two-bar New Orleans breaks. Clarinet. An incessant time is always there. Somebody's playing time. In this case, it's the piano. Now, how are you going to write that down? Comes all right at the end. Check this out. Kid Ory, one of the famous early trombone players. Diminished seventh chord. I love it. That's 1921. No, I'm sorry. That's not right. 1927. Got the wrong glasses. Chicago, Illinois, December 13th, 1927. That was recorded. That's a long time ago. That's pretty sophisticated music for what we've been listening to. And it's really pretty sophisticated music all the way through history. This is where it starts. He's playing what he hears in his head. He plays it on his trumpet, he plays what he hears in his head, the music, and he sings with the music that he hears in the head. And that's what we all do. Ideally, I don't have any music to look at when I'm playing jazz. I'm just simply playing what comes to my ears, and this is supposed to know how to do that, or this is supposed to know how to do that. And that is where all the practice time comes in, is to make that an automatic reaction. When you hear people playing jazz, they may very well just simply be repeating melodic patterns that they've learned, and of course we all do, but hopefully what they're doing is they're thinking up music they want to play, and they're playing it, and it just comes out the end of the horn, in this case out the mouth. There's a myth about that scat, because nobody really had heard that before, and the myth is that the music fell off the stand and he had to sing because he couldn't play. But I don't buy that, because I really don't think there was any music. And I think people that, musicologists will tell us that, you know, people of history, usually white folks, and they'll say, well, obviously the music fell off the stand, and so he had to just simply sing, and the mic was on, and what are you going to do? Well, all you have to do is stop and start again. I don't buy that. I think it was something that he either had been working on, or it did just simply happen, but he sings the way he plays, melodically, rhythmically, style-wise, the whole thing is simply the way he plays the trumpet. And when you hear people play, we're going to get to some singing that's a little bit different than that with Billie Holiday and them, where there wasn't an instrument involved. But the copying of the old question of, are the horn players copying what the singers did? And think all the way back to Bessie Smith and them. Or are the singers copying what the horn players did? And it just depends on who you're talking about. Because obviously Bessie Smith, the way she sang the blues, was something that horn players could copy and did, and vice versa. Because when we get to Billie Holiday, and people talk about how unique her singing style was and how important it was as an influence for what came later, I hear Louis Armstrong in her singing strong. She obviously listened to an awful lot of recordings of Louis Armstrong. Singing or playing the trumpet, it doesn't matter. It was the same thing. One of the things that jazz music did, one of the things that American music did, was change the emphasis rhythmically. Ba, one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. The old joke is, if you want to get people clapping on two and four, play jazz. If you want them on one and three, play country. You know, well, anyway. And I don't know of an example early like this that's stronger than what they did, and whose idea it was, how they did that. They're in a recording studio. Did it all happen some simultaneously? I doubt it. But they did that. Maybe it was Lil Hardin that did it, because she's playing the piano. But it's rehearsed, because they all do it at the same time. And so on. Now, people ask, what's swing? How do you define swing? And almost invariably, we will say, beats me. It either does or it doesn't. And Duke Ellington said something about that once, you know, it doesn't mean anything if it doesn't swing. Well, what is swing? I was in a Q&A with a bunch of teachers, and one of the students said to Rufus Reed, who is one of the major bass players in the world, what's your definition of swing? And he said, any two notes by Paul Chambers. Well, Paul Chambers is the bass player that plays with Miles Davis in the 50s and so on. And Rufus's attitude was, that's swing. If you have to ask, don't bother. It's kind of the other attitude about that. But Louis Armstrong, and the way Louis Armstrong's playing, and the way the musicians that are playing with him are playing, has an awful lot to do with what we call swing. Invariably, it'll say, well, do you feel like dancing? Is this the kind of music that you just simply can't keep your feet still? And how do you define that? How do you figure out musically how to get that done? And again, because it's an oral idiom, it's not a written idiom, you can't write down swing. I think as it develops, and we'll get maybe far enough today to give you an example of, the rhythm section is pushing the time. The rhythm section never really rushes, but it's incessantly pushing. And I think that is, the way Lil Hardin plays piano is a good example of that. You just can't get away from it. Then the horn players feel like they might start slowing down at any moment, but they never do. There's a tension, And the best example I have of that, we won't get to today, but we will next week, and that's Count Basie's mature band. The big band that Count Basie had was perfect. It wasn't quite that well developed or that obvious with Duke Ellington's band and some of those. But Basie's band swings as hard as any band I ever played. And I would sit down, and this is back in the day, thinking, what am I hearing? Why does it feel like this? What are they doing? Because I'm a musician, I have to figure that out. I have to know how to do that. The other night, I played at the Ohio Club, and the rhythm section, especially the drummer, was pushing on us. And I feel so good when I can lean back against that physically. And if I'm rushing, it destroys it. If the drummer is dragging, it destroys it. And I don't mean the tempo is actually changing. So it's a very kind of an esoteric thing. But it comes up every time somebody starts talking about American music. Does a marching band swing? I don't think so. Not in the sense we're talking about. And there's some really good marching bands and concert bands playing marches. But it somehow never quite gets to the feel that you're hearing in this late 20s style of jazz music. Somebody put the name on it. Nobody really knows who it was or why. Well, they know why. But it's a feeling. It comes out of the blues. Definitely comes out of the blues. It's an emotional, grab you and fling you around and throw you up against the wall kind of feeling. You can't get away from it. It makes people weep. It makes people dance. It makes people just break into peals of laughter. It's a feeling that I also can get in very, very good performances of a symphony orchestra. I mean, it's not just this kind of music. I think Bach swings. I think that's why the Swingle Singers picked Bach to so-called jazz it up. But Bach swings, and certainly in the hands of certain people. Go listen to Glenn Gould play the Bach Brandenburg Concerti. Is that right? Goldberg Variations. The Goldberg Variations of piano. Glenn Gould's the one that I hear that just won't let you down. It holds you up against the wall all the way through. Most piano players don't get that feel. And I'm not sure, you can't write it down. Bach didn't write it down. Bach would be one of the great jazz piano players of all time if he were allowed to, no question about that. Because the feeling is there. Okay, on we go. Louis Armstrong goes to New York and is becoming more of an entertainer and more of a, I don't want to say a showman. Later on in his career, he got a lot of flack, especially from the African-American community, for being kind of a show-off or playing to the white folks or whatever you want to say. But he did get into that, and he was really good at it. So the example I have is from the Cotton Club. And you may know about the Cotton Club. It was in Harlem. You would take the A train up to Harlem, go to the Cotton Club. It was one of those places where they were all black entertainers and black musicians, but they couldn't get in the place. It was for the uptown white moneyed establishment to go and have the black musicians entertain for them. And so Louis Armstrong is hired by, it says in this the booklet that I read from, his new Sebastian Cotton Club Orchestra. Well, I don't know about his. But he's becoming well-known on both sides of the racial fence and is got a larger orchestra. And he's beginning to play more pop tunes, if that word isn't too pejorative. This example is Sweethearts on Parade, which was a popular tune of the day. It was recorded in 1930, so we're still not very far along the line as far as dates are concerned. There's quite a large ensemble. It was recorded on OK Records, OKEH, which was one of the so-called race record labels. It was a subsidiary of Columbia Records. But of course, they couldn't put black musicians on Columbia Records. They had to have another label for them. I'd say that with no twinkle in my eye. It was a mess. It still is. Anyway, here's Sweethearts on Parade. Write it down, I dare you. The phrasing. And you've heard it all your life with pop singers and jazz singers singing popular songs, the way it's phrased, Ella Fitzgerald and them. Perfect example of the rhythm section pushing and the soloist leaning back against it. And by standards even today, it just simply swings. It's just, you can't get away from it. Also, the melody, well, I will actually read you this little quote. This is what I read from is the Smithsonian Classic Jazz thing, which has been out of print for years. But it says, and I don't know who wrote it, doesn't matter, Armstrong begins his opening chorus in Sweethearts and Parade so obliquely off the melody that one gets the effort of an introduction and opening statement all in one. Indeed, he seems almost to be tossing random asymmetrical phrases in the air until a particular phrase comes along that somehow ties the previous phrases together. That's a white musicologist writing this, but it is what's happening. I mean, it really is completely away from something that you could write down in whole notes and half notes and quarter notes and have everybody who bought the music play it exactly the same way. It just doesn't happen like that. If it was written down the way it actually sounded with all of the various inflections, I wouldn't want to try and read it. It'd be so complex with accents and phrasings and nuances and timbre, the tone changing, which, as you know, comes right out of the tradition that came over from Africa, and so on. More of it.
It takes more than one to join the army of love. And how I find, as they fall in line, all the sweethearts long for
see if the melodic feel stays the same when he plays trumpet as it was when he was singing. A little quote from another tune at the end. And that's another thing we do all the time. If you play a couple notes and it reminds you of a tune and it fits the harmony at the time, or even if it doesn't, sort of, we drop it in there and they call them quotes. I'm quoting from this tune, quoting from another tune. When we're improvising, we can do that. People don't write it out that way. Matter of fact, they'd have trouble because they'd have to give credit for it. Anyway, that's Louis Armstrong. He's 30 at the time. He was born in 1900. This was recorded in 1930. So all of that development, and we don't know what happened before he started recording in the mid-20s, all of that development is in the first 30 years of his life. And let's say the first, or cancel the first 10, one would think. I don't know when he started playing the cornet. But it's about a 15 to 20 year developmental process. And when you think of it in those terms, it's pretty staggering what actually got done. Now, a little sidelight. There's another musician who's from Davenport, Iowa, who is kind of working on the same stuff. His name is Bix Beiderbecke. He's white. The band that he's playing in, well, various bands. He played with Paul Whiteman's band for quite a long while and was not happy because what he was hearing and the way he wanted to play music was not happening in the Paul Whiteman band. It was a white band, of course. Paul Whiteman was called the king of jazz, something like that, which was, again, the marketing tool for the record companies and all. So Bix didn't play for a very long time, organized a small group. There was a C melody sax player. You don't necessarily need to know what that is. What you're used to is an alto sax, a tenor sax, and a baritone sax. C melody was sort of in the cracks, and it's an obsolete instrument that we don't get to hear anymore, maybe at all. I don't know anybody that plays C melody anymore. I've seen one. But a guy named Frankie Trumbauer was the C melody sax player that played with Bix. I had the great, great fortune of working for years with Frankie Trumbauer's son, Bill, who was the trumpet teacher at UMKC, University of Missouri, Kansas City, where I went and taught for 30 years. Didn't live much longer after the years that I came, but we worked for 2, 3, 4 years together. And he had lots of stories about his dad, who was one of the major jazz artists of the 30s. The record I'm going to play for you is about Frankie Trumbauer, although you'll get to hear Bix play as well. It's a tune called Singin' the Blues. It was recorded in New York City in 1927, so we're still in that decade. But this style of music sends the music into another direction. And later on, when we talk about, if we get that far, the cool school versus the hot school, Louis Armstrong is about the hot school and people who learned from all of this. It's kind of difficult to tell, but maybe you'll be able to tell. They both played cornet, but Louis switched to trumpet very quickly because it has a much brighter sound. It's a much more present sound. Not to put too fine a point on it, but a trumpet is a cylindrical instrument and a cornet is conical, and it makes a mellower sound somewhat. The trombone obviously is cylindrical, or you wouldn't have a slide go back and forth, but the baritone horn, the sister horn, is conical. French horn is conical, tuba is conical. It's not as brassy a sound as the trombone and the trumpet is. Louis was a trumpet player, Bix was a cornet player. The C melody saxophone player, the C melody sax is not a tenor sax with a more earthy sound. It's a mellower sound. And Lester Young is gonna come up today because Lester Young, the tenor sax player who played so much with Billie Holiday and later on with Count Basie, was a serious student of the sound and style of Frankie Trumbauer. He even carried the solo you're about to hear that he had sketched out on paper around in his case for years. And we know this to be a fact. And he said something to the effect of, I like the stories he was telling with his instrument. Interesting. This is Singin' the Blues with Bix Beiderbecke. I think I told you that when Louis ran into Bix musically, maybe even physically, he was surprised to find out that they'd both been working on the same thing. On the one hand, in Michigan, where the Wolverines, the band that Bix was playing in, was playing, and on the other hand, in New Orleans and Chicago. And I don't think that's necessarily true. They were both working on the improvisatory art. There's no doubt about that, and maybe that's all Louis meant. But Louis' music is fiery, and Bix is mellow. And you'll hear at least some of that in this example. This is a C melody saxophone. Thank you. is Bix. You think you can hear a difference in style? It's there. Had they listened to each other before this? Almost undoubtedly. Or at least Bix would have been listening to Lewis records. I don't know about the other way. This was recorded in 1927 as well. So they're both doing the same kind of things the same way, separated by a huge mass of country. So I really don't know. I don't think any historian has really been clear about how much actual physical contact there was, or how much they were able to listen to each other's records. Did Louis Armstrong listen to this record? Almost undoubtedly, because the textbook for the music was the records. And they'd figure out some way, and the word would spread through the community. Hey man, check out so-and-so, you really need to be listening to that. And people would buy records somehow and get it done. They were in the big cities, so there were record stores. The records were the 78 discs, you know, the wax discs. By the way, the music is roughly 3 minutes long, because that's all you could fit onto one of those records, long before LP records. But that's where we went to school. I mean, I literally had a record of J.J. Johnson's trombone that the needle had worn through the record, and it went through. But we would play the same track over and over and over and over again as we were trying to learn that tune. Somebody asked me that just the other day. Did it take a long time for you to learn one song? It took forever. And we still don't know, because there's still so much. And people say, I don't want to hear Body and Soul again. I hear jazz bands, I've heard Body and Soul a lot. I want to hear what the soloist is going to do with it, because it's always different. And it comes out of these guys. This is where it all really got started. That improvisatory art, and it is an art. So Bix is playing a kind of music that certain musicians grab onto, because that's the sound, that's the soul, that's the music that they can identify with best. Other musicians are going to grab on to other musicians, and Bix and Louis were two of the most prominent examples of people that other people got. You need to listen to that. You need to get all the records you can, and over and over and over again, play those things. Lester Young, the tenor sax player, carrying his notated solo of Frankie Trumbauer around in his case. It's quoted here. Well, not anymore, I turned the page. I like the stories they were telling, is what Lester said. Lester's also the guy that said, don't ever play anything if you don't know the words to the, if you don't know the lyrics to the tune you're playing. And we were just commenting the other night that when Paul Stibitz at the Ohio Club was playing his drum solos, you could hear the tune. He was singing the tune that they were playing in his head while he was playing a drum solo. And it wasn't clear. It wasn't like the rhythm of the melody was the only things he was playing. But if you listen, you can hear that he's got the melody in his head. He knows what he's doing. And these guys did too. They knew the melody. They knew the lyrics. If there were lyrics, some of these things didn't have lyrics. Louis Armstrong is singing and playing the same stuff, because it's what he hears in his head. It's what his ears are telling his voice to play. That's easy, because you don't have fingerings to worry about. The hard part is playing the what you hear in your head and knowing what buttons to push down at the same time. That's the tricky part. Now I have to know where to put the slide on my trombone in order to get what I want to play. And sometimes I miss, you know, there are wrong notes in our idiom too. Okay, so we'll go from this then to the 30s. And the 30s, for lots of reasons, presents us with larger ensembles, big bands. It becomes what's known as the swing era. And they're not necessarily talking about the music that swings. They're talking about a kind of music, big band dance music. Glenn Miller, Benny Goodman, all of the names that you know. On the other side of the fence, Fletcher Henderson, Count Basie, Duke Ellington. There were white big bands, there were black big bands, and never the twain shall meet, except on occasion, when somebody who was hip enough, like Benny Goodman, to hire black musicians and have to put up with the fact that he couldn't go down south and play because they wouldn't have that, or a white band with a black singer, a black female singer, was absolutely not what you do. But clarinet player Artie Shaw, with his band, had Billie Holiday up front and got into a lot of trouble, but said, you know, this is my singer, take it or leave it. So there was the beginnings of the breakdown. I've said for years and years and years that music is one of the most important factors in our culture in breaking down racism. And it always seems to precede what's coming. Think about the 60s, the feminist movement, the anti-war movement, the this movement, the that movement. It was in the music practically before it was anyplace else, at least before it was anyplace else visible, or in this case, aural, audio. It's happening in the 30s as well, and in the 20s, because here's the Chess brothers who are willing to record black musicians. We wouldn't have that evidence if they hadn't done that, and all of those blues guys that were going north from B.B. King on up and down were there in part because they knew that they could go to Chess Records and get recorded. Okay, so the first example is a guy named Fletcher Henderson. And Fletcher Henderson has a band early. He becomes an arranger for Benny Goodman's band. But early on, he has a band of his own. And it is really setting up the way big band music is going to be scored for. Of course, the music has to be written at this case because there's 15, 16, 17 musicians. And to get them all playing at the same time, different roles have to be established. There's going to be a drum kit and the drummer's playing what drummers play. There's going to be a bass player. There's going to be a keyboard, probably a guitar, maybe a banjo, but probably a guitar. Then there's going to be a saxophone section, a trombone section, and a trumpet section. And they all have roles to play. And the writer, the arranger, has to figure that out and write it down the way the music is going to sound. And early on, Fletcher Henderson's band, Wrapping It Up is the name of the tune. It's his composition. It was recorded in 1934 in New York. There's a long list of people here that are playing. And that's enough said. Let's just play Wrapping It Up by Fletcher Henderson. This is in the early 30s. Call and response. Thank you. So the intermixing of a solo improviser and written out stuff underneath them, that the horn sort of cooking along underneath the solo, or the back and forthness, call it call and response if you want, is something that the arranger, the music writer, Fletcher Henderson, would have to deal with. Here I've got all these musicians, what in the world am I going to do with them? And some of it comes out of Jelly Roll Morton and the Red Hot Peppers, which wasn't anywhere near this big a band, but the same sort of problems being solved. What's going to be the role of each of the individual things? And what you're hearing, of course, sounds real familiar, because it's still the way big bands are essentially written for. All of the dance music of the 30s is like this. There's a kind of a fun thing I will read for you if I can find my place. Wrapping It Up is one of several pieces that Henderson provided for the Benny Goodman Orchestra. This version, therefore, this version, makes an interesting comparison with Goodman's RCA Victor, so on and so on. The Goodman Ensemble certainly plays with more precision and polish, which was something that white bands tended to do more than the black bands did. Oh, here we are. There are a couple rather obviously sloppy moments in Henderson's recording, but the general emotional tone and effect is quite different. One curious and instructive aspect of the mid-30s Goodman band is that all the brass and reed sections swung, the rhythm section did not. Rhythm sections learned about this swing situation a little later. Gene Krupa was a four-beat bass drum guy, and this is pretty much what he did. It took the 40s with some of those drummers to free the drum kit to be able to be part of the improvisational task, both in terms of the small group and the large group. Note also how indebted Harry James' trumpet solo is to Allen's original. In other words, Harry James is the trumpet soloist with Goodman, and this is in the 30s. Goodman's band became far more historically interesting in the 40s. But Harry James' solo on the recording in the 30s is almost note for note from Allen's, which was the trumpet solo in this. So are they listening to records? You bet. Are they learning how to do things the best they can? Goodman was I don't want to belittle his place in history, because he's extremely important in the 40s. First of all, for a lot of, Fletcher Henderson was writing for him at the time, so the arrangements are Henderson's, but also, of course, his willingness to begin to break down the racial structures that were in the music. So he has Lionel Hampton on vibes and Teddy Wilson on piano. It seems like there was another one. And created an enormous stir because it was an integrated band. I don't know of one that was before that. Even to the point of a friend of mine went up to Count Basie and said, if you ever need an Ofe trombone player, that's us, Ofe. If you ever need an Ofe trombone player, and Basie said, I ain't never gonna need no Ofe trombone player. And with a twinkle in his eye. But nonetheless, a lot of bands, one of the great things about Basie's band, when people began to figure out that it was all black and maybe he was wouldn't hire a white guy and so on, for a long time in the middle of his career, the drummer and the lead trumpet were white, the two most important seats in the band, which said all we needed to know about that. He hired the best he could find. And it just happened that Lynn Bibiano was playing lead trumpet with Basie for a long time. And I'm sure, because I've played sometimes the only white guy in the band, I'm sure that there was no back and forth flack about that, not inside the band. The flack was out there. But if you could play, you could play. And if you couldn't play, that was that. And there's an old story. Joe Jones was going to be the drummer for Basie's band for a long time, but he was playing with a small group in New York, in Kansas City, and young Charlie Parker walked in and sat in with the band, and it was just awful. And the story goes, and I've had it confirmed numerous places, Joe Jones takes one of his cymbals and throws it across the room and pretty much tells him to get off the bandstand and go learn how to play, which he did. but that story is legion, and it points to the fact that doesn't matter who you are, it matters whether you can play or not. And it doesn't take very long to figure that out. So Fletcher Henderson's band, Fletcher Henderson really did figure it out. Benny Moten is a band leader in Kansas City. And what I'm going to play for you is not really Kansas City style yet. We'll get a chance to really pin that down next week. The difference between Duke Ellington and Count Basie, the difference between New York and Kansas City. Moten's Swing by Benny Moten's band is an example of where that a lot of the players in the band are going to be in Basie's band, including Count Basie himself, who's playing piano. But this is, and the date is 1932, we're still pretty early, Benny and Buster Moten, two cousins, if I'm not correct, if I'm not wrong. Benny and Buster Moten led the band. Benny Moten's Kansas City Orchestra is what it's called. And the tune that one of the two of them wrote, nobody's really sure, is called Moten Swing. That's Basie on piano, still in the old Stride style, pretty much. Response back and forth. Boogie woogie style piano for a minute. Now this is beginning to approach what we're going to call Kansas City jazz. A soloist playing a solo, an improvised solo, like you're used to hearing by now, with riffs behind him or her, and there were some hers, but this is not really straight riffing, like, and we'll get into it in detail next week. But a riff is a small rhythmic slash melodic phrase that's repeated over and over again. Basie's theme song, that's it, because it just repeats over and over and over and over again. It's a blues tune. It's a four-bar melody. Basie gets credit for composing 1 o'clock jump, whatever it is. But it's just simply a four-bar fragment that repeats over and over again. But the thing is, those guys really couldn't read music. And there were a standard set of riffs, and the lead saxophone player would start playing one, and they would harmonize it, they being the sax players. The trombones would riff, the trumpets would riff. Sometimes the brass section would riff as an entity, but sometimes there'd be the trumpet riff and the trombone riff and the sax riff all sort of boiling around underneath the solo. And you can hear six or eight versions of that song on different records, and it'll be the same riffs but in different order. It's just whoever, the lead guy will call it out and they'll harmonize it. I watched Neil Hefti rehearse a new composition with Basie's band. This is in 1958. And there were half the band was had comic books on their music stands. They didn't have music. He was simply by rote. He was singing what he wanted them to do, and they played it that night. Think about that. So that's where this is starting to develop from. And this is Benny Moten's band. There are several people in the band you don't really care. Walter Page is going to be in Basie's band on bass. Basie on piano, of course. Ben Webster is from St. Joe, Missouri, and he's down in Kansas City playing. A lot of the musicians in Kansas City came out on the train and with touring bands and got dropped off there. That was the end of the tour. And they had to hang around and wait for a ride back east on another band. There were territory bands that went out in buses to Oklahoma and Texas and so on. But the main flow now is back and forth between New York and Kansas City and Chicago, and then eventually all the way to LA. And that, again, is something for next time. We're just about out of time now. But you can sort of see how this is going to develop. There's two main schools of big band writing, and I use the term loosely, in Kansas City. Definitely over here, Duke Ellington is composing. The more we do research, the more we find out that Billy Strayhorn wrote most of that stuff, that Ellington really didn't. All these years when I've said that the most important American composers are not Aaron Copland and Leonard Bernstein and them, it's Duke Ellington and Jimi Hendrix and John Coltrane. Well, maybe not Duke Ellington as much as we thought. A lot of that's Billy Strayhorn was in the background writing. Duke would write four or five, six little measure things and said, finish it. Whether it was Satin Doll, a tune we all know, or even like three movement suites, I think that probably Billy wrote most of that. But it's being written, and those musicians can read music. They're good at it. They're schooled musicians. Over here, it's not so much that way. And the tendency here is to be interested in improvisation more than anything else. And people like Charlie Parker and all develop out of that way of doing things. And the bands simply provided a cushion, a background upon which to solo. And we begin to see the breakdown of the old traditional rhythm section guys as well. That was more thump, 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 thump than anything else. Like, for instance, the Little Hardin piano that we heard, where the drummer begins to be able to play different things with all four extremities, which boggles my mind to this day. And the bass player has a very distinct role, and Rufus is going to say, you want to know what swing is? Listen to the bass player, who's just driving incessantly. You can't get away from it. And of course, you're not supposed to. And the horns being so laid back, we've said about some of the bassy recordings that the horns are playing a bar behind the rhythm section. Well, no, they're not. But it does sound like they're behind the beat. For a long time, I played with the studio band, the country club band in Kansas City. And for a number of years, we had a young drummer who was trying desperately to be good and followed. And the saxophone players would be behind, and the drummer would go with them, and the band would just simply slow down. And all of the energy was gone. It was, I mean, people wouldn't dance. They were all sitting out there. And we all knew what the problem was, but the leader, for whatever the reason, decided he was going to stick with this guy. Alan Carter, I can still remember his name. And he was not up front driving the time, and the band didn't swing. And the sax players in particular were bugged. Because the lead alto, his job really was to hold that back, to be almost dragging, to almost feels like it's going to slow down, and then let this people push along and wasn't pushing. That's as close as I can come to a definition of what swing really means. And so we'll examine that in more detail yet next week.